It gives me a great pleasure and honor to introduce our speaker tonight. God has blessed him in a tremendous way. Our Lord has given this pastor favor. Favor in speaking the word of God. Favor in having a relationship with his God. Elder McWilliams, our Christian Education Director. Let's give God a praise for him. Please stand, Elder McWilliams. Please stand. Give God a praise for our Christian Education Director. We thank God for him. He was asking me if I have anyone in mind or he wanted to speak to me about who to use on tonight. At one time, I was thinking that we would have an out-of-town speaker. But Elder McWilliams spoke to me and told me who his choice was. And I said, well, I didn't say this to him, but I'm letting you know that instead of just an out-of-town speaker or out-of-district speaker, God wanted to have an out-of-sight speaker. Hallelujah. And I'm so glad who we have coming before us tonight. A sincere person that loves God. But more importantly, he loves to preach and teach the Word of God in accuracy. Oh, hallelujah. We don't need someone just to tell us what we want to hear. We need to have someone to say to us what God is saying that he wants us to hear and receive. And I'm so glad that we have Second Bishop Lee Andrew Talbert Jr. that is going to come before us tonight to speak into our spirit what thus saith the Lord. He also has another plus on his side because he married my sister. Hallelujah. Sister Gail Marie Foster Tolbert. Amen. Please stand, Sister Gail. This is my sister. No, I'm asking her to stand. Amen. This is my sister. When I was a little boy, 2 or 3 years old, when we lived, I can remember this, that I used to sleep in her bed. She used to take care of me, and I don't remember her changing my diapers. She just told me that's what she wanted. That's what she used to do, you know, when I get a little, you know, heady and high, man, I used to change the diapers, boy. Hallelujah. But I'm glad that Mr. Lee Colbert had enough God sense in here to realize who to pick to be beside him. He not only loved his father, who was a great man of God, Lee Colbert Sr., but he also loved my father, Mr. James Philip Foster. He loves the people of God. I want you to really see what God is going to say to you tonight in the Word of God. I'm excited because I get to hear from the Lord tonight. What thus saith the Lord, to help me to be a better person, help me to be a better leader, help me to be a better husband, help me to be a better son, help me to be a better saint, help me to be a better brother. I get to hear what Jesus is saying to us tonight. Is the choir going to come before us one more time? Well, I guess the choir is not going to sing. If we wanted a song, I could sing. Go tell it on the mountain. Amen. But whatever, we're going to hear We're going to go straight to the man of God and hear the preached word of God. Please stand. I want you to point the hand toward Bishop Tobin and tell him, please, Bishop, tell us what the Lord is saying to us. We need to hear it. We must hear it. Because we want to do right. Now give God a praise and pray for the man of God as he comes. Praise the Lord, everyone. You may be seated. Very humbled by such an introduction. And certainly we are getting to the age where I guess when we get this over, really mean no disrespect, Bishop. But there are some things that we have to tell. Amen. I too thank God for this council session. Thank God for the head of the, what is it, Christian Education. I call it Sunday School, but I thank God for him. Elder McWilliams on Sunday, he and the youth leader, Bill Boyd, showed up. And I have one of these new iPhones, but I really don't know how to use it. I guess they told me they were coming, but they left a message. So I didn't know they were going to be here. But I thank the Lord for he and the Sunday school, or the young people's leader who really blessed us on Sunday morning. I thank God for this particular night that is Christian education. I thank God for all of the pastors that are involved. Thank God for the pastor's wives. And most importantly, for this bishop that is over this greater Tri-State Council, thank God for him. And for all those of you who are God's people who are sitting here tonight, God has a reason for our being here. We are just blessed of the Lord. Amen. I believe that God's people are the most blessed people on the earth. Amen. There's no greater people anywhere than God's people. And I was so inspired by it. I thought the message had already been preached. Bishop Mark, amen. Bishop Elder Mark, amen. He told us about those suits. Amen. I just know he wrote some extra money in the offering because God. What store was that? I want to check it out. And I thank the Lord for him. I understand there's some misfortune in the Anderson family, but I miss your father. And our hearts are really knitted together with all of the brethren that are here. And I know that God brought us together tonight for a reason. Amen. And I would like to do this in a hurry, but I really can't. The old song said, "You can't hurry God." Amen. But my fond thoughts as I think about this church and our past, I know Bishop mentioned that I love my father and I love his father. I have pictures, beautiful pictures of both his father and mother, and my father and my mother that I'm planning on putting in my office. I'm getting them ready now. Amen. They're inspiring. But I thank the Lord when I was looking for a spouse, but a hand. Amen. I knew about Elder Foster, but I had to meet Mother Foster. Amen. And I saw that she was a well-kept individual and a beautiful woman. Amen. I thank God for her. I said, you know, my imagination started working. So his mother can have all these kids, amen, and be this age, and she looks like this, amen. See, some of y'all don't know how to imagine this. Amen. But I certainly remember many things about my father and as well as Bishop Foster. But I remember one time we were headed down the highway to one of the preachers that he got started. And, you know, there's reasons why he started preaching, pastoring. And Elder Foster, of course, was riding along. We two were the only ones in the car. He was humming something. Pretty soon he said, "Lee," he said, "I'll talk if you say something." Amen. One other time, Elder Foster said, I asked him something in Bible class, and he got me one day. He said, Lee, I see you all day. He said, how come you don't ask me them questions when you're around the house? But I just thank God for the relationship. I was only in Omaha, I think, 10 years, but I certainly grew close to this family as well as close to my family. And I do feel a burden from the Lord for this group of people. And I feel the need to be unified and to be what the Lord would have us to be. I feel a special closeness. I was especially listening when the chairman asked about a praise. And then the bishop got up and asked for a praise. And I started thinking everybody was kind of doing the same thing, you know. And that was a young man from South Korea. What's that new dance he came up with? Gangnam Style or something like that? You know, he was doing this, you know. And I thought, why can't the saints have the kind of imagination, I think that's what you're looking for, that would allow us to come up with enough things? Oh, yeah. See, I come out of the days when, you know, the preacher would say something and everybody would say, yeah. I mean, until I got to Davenport. You know, I would call my text and say, well, tonight I'm going to speak on. Yeah. Oh, yeah, that would be a roar deacon. I'd like to go to the Baptist churches sometimes. They know how to talk to you. Amen. But somehow, I want to ask a question. I want to give some challenges to the church tonight. What kind of counsel would this counsel be if I used my imagination? And I want to take this question a little bit further. What kind of person would counsel me if I used my imagination? What kind of home would you have? How many people in your family would be saved if you used your imagination? I know some of you are Bible students. You know already that the word imagination is found in the Bible 14 times. And it's only used one time in a positive vein. And tonight, we're going to look at that positive imagination. But I want to challenge the church. I want to challenge the council. I want to challenge every individual to question your ability to think for yourself. God gave each of us a brain. As my mother would say, use it. Amen. So I want to call your attention to two passages of Scripture. One's in the Genesis, the 11th chapter, verse 1 through 9. Genesis, the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 9. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass, it never comes to stay. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar. And they dwelt there, and they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime they had for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us up a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven.
Let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord God said, behold, the people is one. Everybody repeat after me. The people is one. And they have all one language. Say one language. And this they begin to do, and now nothing, say nothing, will be restrained from them, which they have imagined, look at somebody and say, imagined, to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. Sometimes I feel that spirit working in the church today. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad from the face of all the earth. I want to jump from there to the book of First Chronicles, the 29th chapter, verses 16 through 18. First Chronicles 29, 16 through 18. O Lord, our God, all this store that we have prepared to build thee a house for thine holy name cometh of thine hand, and is all thine own. I know also, my God, that thou triest the heart, and hast pleasure in uprightness. As for me, in the uprightness of mine heart, I have willingly offered all these things, and now I have seen with joy thy people which are present here to offer willingly unto thee. O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, our fathers, keep this forever in the imagination of the thoughts of the heart of thy people, and prepare their heart unto thee, or establish their heart unto thee, or establish their mind unto thee. And I want to use for a thought, and perhaps what happened to me when I met my wife. I used my imagination. I think there's a song that says, just my imagination running away with me. Amen. I think I remember my wife saying, when I took her to the zoo, I said, now see, there's a beautiful little boy. I said, we could make one just like that. Sure enough, we made two of them. But in the, and I thank God for my wife being here, as well as some of the members of Christ Temple, thank God for coming down over the highways. I want to emphasize the fact that when God designed us, He designed us to have an impact on the earth. He designed us to make a difference. He said, you're the salt of the earth. You're the light of the world. In other words, people are supposed to know that we're here. Amen. I heard the chairman talking about praise, and I just want to emphasize the fact that every time we come here, we ought to have a praise. And I want to add to that a little bit. Everybody here needs a personal praise. There needs to be a praise that you have in your secret closet, a prayer and a praise that you can make war on the devil. Amen. You can cause people who are lost around you to be changed. All right. But, you know, next, there ought to be a local praise. There ought to be a praise that we as saints, when we meet together in the city that we live in, we ought to have a kind of a praise that's unique to us. Amen. A kind of a praise that just cements our relationships together, causes us to grow and unlock new possibilities every time we meet. Amen. Somehow we have shackled the power of the human brain to make a difference. Amen. I have a tendency sometimes to get sidetracked, but I do believe this brain that we have is powerful. Amen. God designed it, and I understand we only use less than 10% of it. Amen. Can you imagine if we were to get this brain to work? I do believe that if we could get our brains to work and begin to use our imagination in not just our personal praise, because it's not just about me, amen, but in our local praise, and then I believe our communities would be blessed if we had a local praise. Many of the problems that we delegate and complain about in our communities would be affected. But I also believe there is a national praise. There should be a national praise and a global praise. So we have a responsibility. Amen. We have a responsibility, and we have the option of possibilities of things happening if we could just get our minds to work. Because I believe the appropriate praise, and I'm using the word appropriate praise, because there is an appropriate praise for the situation that you face. There are appropriate prayers that we need to learn to pray to set the atmosphere in order to receive or to have the deliverances or the miracles of God come in. Amen. Our theme is order promotes growth. Amen. So just imagine, what would things be like if we were in the order that God wants us to have and growth was coming like it should be? Amen. Well, just think, what would it be like? Can I use my imagination? If there were so many folks crowded in here tonight that we needed twice or three times the usher staff, amen, and we didn't have chairs, we had to make room on the floor, and there was standing room only. What would it be like if people were outside trying to get in? Amen. And we had to put a screen outside and a speaker. So just imagine, amen, what is limiting us from getting to that point where we begin to break through some of the, just imagine. And I want someone to kind of catch that with me. Let's begin to dream, you know, different people. I was a human resource professional, and I learned how to stomach just about every kind of individual, because every kind of individual has something to bring to the table. Amen. All your IT people sometimes are like watching paint dry. And if you think that's bad, engineers. Amen. But if you ever want to learn what the engineer knows about your problem and you want it fixed, you've got to let him start way down here at X equals, and then he's going to work it all the way down, and mumble, jumble, mumble, and about 2 days later, and here is the result. Amen. But you see, some of us, we like to say, keep certain people and throw certain folks away. When we begin to work in the area of possibilities, we have to look at that broke down person, that person that has been cast aside and rejected, and like, what is possible in this person's life? And what is it that God has planned for him? And somehow, I believe not only is God doing something for that individual, but he's doing something for us. I looked up a quick definition of the word imagine, because it's a word that if you are not a thinking person, I think you need to get into your vocabulary. Out of a simple dictionary, it says to form an image of something in your mind. To form an image or idea of somebody or something in the mind. To see or hear something unreal. Okay, now remember when they say, you know, that's imaginary. I'm not talking about talking to an imaginary friend. Nothing like that. Amen. I'm talking about saints of God imagining things in faith. Okay? That should be. Amen. Now, one of the terms is to assume something. Well, I know we don't do a lot of assuming, but I do believe one of the concepts we use in sports is to visualize. Visualize. I don't believe we do enough, and you know, we come up with these same old praises. You know, I would like one time just to see somebody do a praise that was somehow crazy and different than what they did. This man now has made $1 million and got contracts, you know, with this crazy dance. Amen. What about a new praise for the Lord? Amen. And you know, sometimes I think we're the ones that set the tone for that, because we sit back in judgment and say, well, you know, when I went to church, this is how we did it back then. Amen. But you know, you don't know how I feel about what he's done for me. Amen. And he's done so much for me that I just can't tell it all. Amen. So sometimes I believe you need to do like the Lord, had his way. Amen. So I believe, and I want this to be a part of what you jot down as something I want the Lord to do for us. Everyone in the church and in your daily life has as much to do with your behavior as it does with your thinking. This message is to address your thoughts and thinking about our purpose and our power. Most of us, and I don't know with all of us, most of us are unaware of really who we are. Most of us are unaware of the power that we have. The thought came to me, and this is not a part of my message, but I thought, you know, when they woke Jonah up, when he was down in the belly of that ship, the storm was raging. Everybody knew God was man. But Jonah. As a matter of fact, Jonah was trying, I think, to put it out of his mind because he was asleep. But they woke him up. They said, look, we didn't talk to everybody on this ship. They woke him up. He said, well, I'll tell you what, if you throw me overboard, was he lying? You know, now, and I do believe, now I'm talking about thinking. Sometimes we think when trouble comes, it's everybody else. I heard the bishop say something about growing is not necessarily in numbers, but in spirit. Amen? How many of us will have the nerve to say, it's me, it's me, it's me, Lord? And then he had the nerve to say, if you throw me overboard, I ain't going to preach that tonight. If you throw me overboard, the waters will calm down. Now, it takes quite a person that has quite a relationship with God to have that kind of understanding and to make that kind of commitment. Amen. But some of us need to take a look at that book and find out, am I the one? It's not using my imagination. And I, the one that's causing this storm to brew. It's over this council. It's over my home. It's over my local church. It's over my life. Amen. So, I believe if you want to get your thinking right, and I appreciate my parents because when we were growing up, and I think we departed from this, we say the blessing now. But when I was growing up, we said a blessing, and you didn't put your hands on that table till the verse was said. And you know what? We knew that, so everybody had a verse ready just in case somebody else wasn't up pretty quick. Amen. And one of those verses was, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And we wear that out a while then. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Well, you know, back then, it was just a dinner verse. But later on in life, it became a part of our thinking. Amen. It became a challenge. It became something that guided us through the troubled waters of life. Amen. So, I'd like to call in the book of Mark, the 6th chapter, verse number 33. It says, "Seek his righteousness, and all of these things will follow." Amen. And in other words, I think in the King James it says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things." Now, some of you may have heard somebody say something about money troubles. You really need to get into your Bible and find out who controls all the money, all of the authority, and all of the power. Because if it's just money that you want, God controls that. And if I were you, I would look and figure out what it takes to get it from God. Because I think there's a scripture that said, the cattle on 1,000 hills belong to him. And whatever it is that he has, if you want him, he said, ask, and it will be given. So we need to understand, amen. And so I believe what we need to do, first of all, it's difficult to get a person to appreciate wealth when you don't really appreciate who you are. All right? If you don't really understand your authority in this earth, amen. But I want you to know that you are a gift to this city. Bishop, you're a gift to this city. They don't know what they have in you. Amen. Pastor Anderson, you're a gift to your city. You're a gift to your church. And you know what? Every member, every person that's filled with the gift of the Holy Spirit, you are special to God. You know what? If God thought so much of you, that he gave his only begotten son. I'm going to tell you, now, I'm cover over my stuff pretty well. I don't throw nothing away unless it's ready to be thrown away. But you know what? As ugly, as bad as you may be acting, if God shed his blood and applied it to you, look at Peter. Peter wasn't the kind of man that just said no. He emphasized his no with, you know. And when they told him, yes, Peter, he was with him. He didn't just say no. Amen. He wasn't educated and doctor material and, you know, PhD material. He was just a hardcore, rough, and tumble, my kind of man. Okay? So, what am I saying? God loved Peter just as much as he loved Paul. Both of them were tough men. Hey, Paul was standing there with people's coats and they were stoning Stephen. Paul was a bad man. But God loved him. So I'm saying to those of you who perhaps the devil has somehow said, because you made a mistake, bumped your head, fell down, got up again, try and make you feel that you're no longer special to God. Let me tell you, you are a gift from God. The reason I know you are a gift from God is you have the gift. Now, you know, people are funny because I want you to use your imagination. You ever get a gift from a friend? You ever get a gift from the first thing you do? Well, take it. And you get a box. Amen. You shake it. And then you tear into it, but you really can't see what's in the box until you get it out of the box. I want to say tonight that in spite of all of your fears and all of your failures, all of your hurts, all of your misfortunes, the only way we're going to use our gift is we've got to get out of the box. We got to start thinking out of the box. We got to have faith that's out of the box. My faith can't stick in your parameters because God made me different from you. I'm not going to sing like you. I'm not going to preach like you. I'm not going to act like you because God made me different.
and I'm special. I'm going to give God the glory the way that I know how to give God the glory. And he tells me to lay on the floor, I'm going to lay on the floor. He tells me to jump up and down, I'm going to jump up and down. I know God deserves all of the glory.
Amen. I'm talking about out-of-the-box faith and out-of-the-box thinking and out-of-the-box imagination. Amen. I want to talk about the illustration a little while about as Jesus talked to the woman. We talk about this quite often. The Samaritan woman. Jesus asked her for some water. And, you know, I think this woman was a worldly woman, and perhaps she maybe thought Jesus was maybe coming on to her, you know. But Jesus said to this woman, he said, if you knew who I was, and who it is that saith unto you, to give him water, he said, I could give you that living water. You know what Jesus was talking about? He's saying, I could give you eternal life. I could give you a water. Something about, and see, I think this is where we miss out when the scripture says we have the gift of the Holy Ghost. Because we have gotten away from the growing, the digging in the ground and growing food. You know, y'all know we got people in Mississippi and people in Arkansas. And y'all just here. Well, you know where we're from. Amen. Well, water, you need water to grow most everything. Amen. And you know what? When you have living water, matter of fact, if you just have regular water, you can grow stuff in a desert. I don't care how dry it is, the church that you come from, and how bad the state is, or the corner you live on, amen, if you could get out-of-the-box thinking and prayers and out-of-the-box praise and out-of-the-box imagination, you might could meet up on that corner across the street from where that pusher is doing his stuff. You don't have to say nothing to him, but just have a little prayer meeting. It may not look like you're praying. You just might be standing there in a circle, but I dare you to call up the power of heaven. The Spirit of the living God is able to clean off that corner, and not just the corner. I go down to the courthouse where it seems like justice is no longer there, and have a little prayer and walk around the courthouse a little bit. Amen. And tell Jesus about our problems. Well, y'all talk about our problems quite a bit. Amen. But we've got to learn how to take that time and imagine, Lord, what is it that I can do in this time? And you know, the Lord brings a thought to me now as I think about the position that he puts us in. Elijah came to this woman's house. It was a famine. He says, make me a cake. She said, you know, we were just getting ready to eat this last cake in back. Now, here's the man of God. Here's you. Okay, here's you. They done brought this to you. He said, look, make me this cake. Now, that takes some imagination. That takes some special faith. Amen. Honey, you go ahead and make me that cake. She made the cake, and the Bible says God replenished the oil and the meal in her barrel until the end of the famine. They never ran out. Now somebody might say, well, Pastor, that was legend. Well, listen, Jesus said, greater works. He said, greater works. What we do, so I feel, and you know, there used to be a time when I enjoyed the preacher's style, and I understand what it means to preach and how you preach, and but listen, as I got a little older, and I could still do that, but the Lord began to do something else in me. I found that God has a prophetic move that he wants to do in the church. And there are some of you that God wants to speak through, not to give a message, but to bring deliverance. Whether it be your family going to be saved, or whether it be your daughter's going to be delivered from drugs, or whatever it might be. If God moves upon you with that message, that's what we gotta move. Amen. It's no longer as we were raised up sometimes. God knows it. Elder, and I called him Elder Foster. I hate to call Elder because he was a bishop to me. I'm talking about you. But I know if he was still living, who knows, Waterloo, y'all, I might still be here. Amen. He was a person, but you see, back in those days, it seems like what we were establishing in the churches were we had tons of men and tons of women that were there because it just seemed like God wanted you to be there. But you know, there was always something that happened that caused us to split and splutter and scatter. And you know what? If you go back to the book of Genesis, God looked at those people at Babel. Now, here's the situation. These people were the survivors of the flood. These were Noah's children. God's will was that they be scattered to repeople the earth. Come on. Here's what happened. Their imagination was to build a tower. We can leave ourselves, it will be great. Read the scripture. The Spirit of God looked on the people and said they have one language. Every time one wants to go do something, the other one wants to go do it. So they travel together. Look at that scripture. It's just the opposite of how we are now. Amen. Pastor, can I get somebody to go to the council?
No, Pastor.
Look at it. So God looked at this situation. There he is, my horn player. So God looked at this situation. And he said, you know, and I want the saints to understand this. God said, in these people who were not spirit-filled and not, they were not in the will of God, he said, they can do whatever they imagine. What we have in us is something God put in us that either we're going to use it for the devil or we're going to use it for God. And that is why this particular scripture in the 29th chapter of the First Chronicles, the 18th verse, it talks about the imaginations and the thoughts that we have. And I honestly believe, he says, O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, keep this forever in the imagination of the thoughts of the hearts of thy people and prepare their hearts unto thee. What's he talking about? I believe what he was talking about is what they had just done. And again, I'm not going to take time to go through the history of this particular scripture, but they had just finished raising millions of dollars to build a temple for the Lord. And one thing that I liked about what David said, he said, Lord, we have not prepared this place for us, but we prepared this place for you. And you know, people of God, I believe in this age of tangibility, things that we touch, see, and feel, those of us who, even working men, can enjoy stuff that at one time was not in our reach. We got timeshares, and we do travel on ships. Some people do. I mean, we're enjoying stuff, staying in big hotels. This stuff used to not be possible. So there are many of us who are getting to the point where we're feeling like, well, I'm doing all right. Amen. But I'm just wondering, are you doing all right as a person? And of course, it's a blessing from God, but it's one of the gifts of God for you to enjoy your wealth. But it's not a gift from God for you to ignore the house of God. Amen. Because that's the part that brings joy. And again, I could preach out on any one of these tangents, but I got something I just want to give you. I believe when Jesus told the woman by the Samaritan woman about the living water, or the woman by the well about the living water, he was talking about not water that had come from, and I think this is the way they handle it in some of the commentary. You know, you can drink water from anybody ever drink water out of one of these lakes around Omaha? You know, got mold going, all the algae going around. Amen. I would much more rather drink water out of a living stream where it's kind of bubbling up out of the rocks and moving constantly and flowing down the hillside. And Jesus sort of drew a contrast with her. He said, if you knew who I was, amen. And each of us need to really know who Jesus is. He's not giving us that stagnant water, but he's giving us the kind of water that can new joy, new hope, a new desire. Amen. The kind of water that can, oh, have mercy, cleanse every spiritual disease. And there's no fear that God can't purify. You don't have to worry about being inadequate because the water that he gives is a purifying portion. Amen. So, saints of God, amen, we need to know who we are. Amen. We have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Bible in Romans 6 and 23 says that eternal life is the gift of God. And Ephesians 2 and 8 says salvation is a gift of God. Jesus Christ is a gift. He is a gift from God. Amen. His righteousness in Romans 14 and 17, it says the gift of God is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. So, in Ecclesiastes 3 and 13, 5 and 19, it says, enjoying the fruit of your labor and the riches is the gift of God. Amen. The scripture says the Holy Ghost is the gift of God. Amen. So I just want, as we look at these various situations in the Bible, I want to challenge you to figure out what it is that we couldn't do better together. Amen. What would Bishop Foster feel and think if we were unified? Imagine what your family would be if we could gather together. All it does promote growth. Growth is actually fruitfulness and getting things done. I just would like for you to envision a battle between two forces fighting for domination and control. The larger the battlefield, the greater the need for leadership and discipline of troops. If there is no unity, there can be no order. If there is no order, there can be no victory. We are not winning in certain areas because we have no unity. If the general tells the soldiers in charge and the soldiers tell the general no, amen, or some version of no, perhaps the most telling scripture is the one that I talked about at the Tower of Babel. Amen. When the generals say charge, amen, we need to charge. It's not for us to understand whether or not we have the forces required to win the battle. Amen. Many times in the scripture, amen, when Joshua hit the battle of Jericho, amen, the Bible says they went out with horns and, amen, oh yes, they had weapons, but, amen, when the battle was called for, amen, the man of God said, I want you to raise your trumpets and blow. Amen. But, you know, probably the most difficult thing at that circumstance was he told them, I want you to shut up for 7 days. Now, y'all know that would be the greatest challenge. Amen. And those people had to walk around that rail, amen, for 7 days and not utter a word until the minister. I think that order promote growth. Amen. Because they took the city. Amen. When it finally became time to shout, they shouted. And you know what? They never had to lift their weapons. Amen. For the Lord fought their battles. Amen. He caused the enemy to turn around themselves. It reminds me of the scripture that said, no weapon, no weapon, no weapon. If I know that I'm the best and that's where I'm at, Lord, I know
that can come against me. Tony reminds me of when my son was traveling in Spain. Amen. His house father and mother told him, they said, now, John, when you're in town, if trouble comes up, you just give them my name. I understand he had some ties to the undercurrent in the city. And when they saw his name, they would back off. We have the same kind of relationship with God. And when we are going to face the adversary, then we God is there. And I wish the whole song would say, I don't understand why we haven't used our Christian mathematics and our imaginary calculators. Because my Bible says, what time of the world are we going to do in the world? That's what I'm going to ask you. What are you talking about? I'm telling you, we've got to get our language unified. We've got to rehearse our speech. We've got to get together and get our lines together. We can't let the devil see us back. We can't let him see us talking about it. We can't let him see us talking about it. He said the people have run. In other words, they are unified. He said the people got one language. When you got one language, I know a little German, but I wouldn't be able to understand much. But you know, when you learn a language and you learn another language, you got to go rehearse it in the real language that you know, and then try to reassign. It's a complicated process. And as he told me, was still speaking in tongue language. I don't know. Well, maybe. But the Bible says, let me tell you something. And the handcuffs off, and you think what you're saying is hurting somebody, the Lord knows how to send it out there and make it fall right. So while you're sitting back chicken, and I think this is what God had in mind with Peter, he said, well, I know Peter's going to say whatever he got to say to get the job done. But Peter was a little chicken when he went to the Gentiles, because God meant for him to go to the Gentiles. And he started trying to put circumcision on the Gentiles. And God said, no, I better send Paul. Oh, yeah. Peter was so messed up. Now, I hate to say it, but I think maybe a little prejudice there because, you know, when he got around them two crowds together, he kind of acted different. Now, y'all know we like him. You know, those folks, you can tell when somebody don't like you. Okay? You can tell, and they picked it up on Peter. So God had to send Paul. But that's not my message for tonight. I just want to, as I close, Solomon was the richest man. Richest man in the world. But you know, his father set him up. If you look at that prayer that his father prayed, because there are two prayers in Solomon's life that are very noteworthy. If you look at 29:1, furthermore, David, the king, said unto the congregation, Solomon, my son, whom alone God has chosen, is yet young and tender, and the work is great. For the palace is not for man, but for the Lord God. So his father was praying, but you know, there's another thing, and I think if you all want wealth and power, when Solomon was praying to God as he was anointed to be king, he did not ask God for a lot of stuff. He asked God, Lord, give me wisdom to lead and guide this people. He touched God's heart so. He said, you know, because you asked for wisdom, he said, I'm going to give you riches. I'm going to give you honor among men. And you're going to be so rich. You know? Man, okay, I would like for the Lord to say that about me. And you know the other thing he said, you didn't pray for me to kill your enemy. Y'all ever prayed that prayer? He said, you didn't pray for me to kill your enemies. You didn't pray for riches, but you prayed for wisdom and discretion. You know, it looks like anybody that don't have money should figure out how to get it through God, because the Bible says all of the riches of heaven belong to him. Amen. So as I close, and I just believe that I want to solicit each person in this council to help me make the devil quit messing with my stuff and your stuff. Amen. This world that we're in, some of us are looking at each other cross-eyed because we think that it was Sister So-and-so. She had just not stepped on my toe. If she hadn't said this to me, I would have.
It ain't about that. Amen. We need to stop the devil from messing with our stuff. Amen. The devil will make you so mad at your brothers and your sisters. You had the Holy Ghost so long that you ain't thought about killing nobody, but the thought kind of popped up.
You haven't thought about killing nobody in a long time, but
you begin to have mercy on folk because you say, oh, you may not have said a bad word in a long time, but I still know them words. So as a council, we need to lift up the office of the bishop. We need to lift up the office of the pastors, the office of each of our individual churches, and every individual member. We need to lift each other up before God. Challenge your mind and your imagination to make a difference. Amen. To make a difference in the, oh, Lord, have mercy. You know, we spent so much time. Yes, God divided us because he wanted the four corners of the earth to be saturated. But once he got it saturated, he wanted us to have that one man. And you see, the scripture says, create in me a clean heart. And renew in me a right spirit. Oh, Lord. So you see, even though I'm separated and in another state, there's something that connects us. I don't have to come in and know everything that's going on. It's something about in the spirit. We kind of got up to speed. I can feel your closeness, and I know what you're going through. And sometimes my wife and I have been married 47 years. Sometimes you know what I want or what I'm going to say before I say it. just kind of bees that way. And you know what? We as a church, I'm not talking about just on a church level, but I'm talking about it ought not be no difference when I come to the council. It ought to be, now we getting ready to go have that church. You know what I'm saying? We had a little 22 at the house. But now we didn't want to use the Mac 10. You know what I'm saying? We can get the 12. You know what I mean? I'm just saying, we ought to be able to look forward because God is going to do something different. Why? Because I gave him a different praise. I quit giving him that That's why I say, whatever that dance is, look like the saints ought to come up. Amen. I think back on the old saints, back in Great River Land. Man, we had one brother stand up, he said, some folks might laugh, but at least the man found a way to give a different praise. We think everybody didn't cut their pews on church, or their teeth on church pews that we did. They come in off the street. I remember Elijah Landrum used to come into church. Amen. Some of y'all remember Friday night? It was always, man, Elijah's door would open up, boom, all the way down to the front, all the way over to this side, all the way back over to that side. I don't know what he was doing. Because he worked construction all day long. Amen. But I'm telling you, you cannot tell me. You see, it doesn't take money to give a man joy. It's more than money. Amen. For a child of God to be fulfilled. And this is one of the tricks you learn about being with one person for 100 years. You try to make it like the first time you ever saw her. Oh, honey, I like that dress. Well, she had that same one on last week. But you got to see it like it was new. You know what I mean? The same wisdom that we use to get along for a number of years. Some of y'all who still waiting to get a chance. Amen. It takes work to make it. Amen. You know, we got to be able to look at each other and see, hey. How does it look, honey? Oh, wait! What do you think about the Lord? Amen. You know, it looks like the Lord don't get tired of blessing us, but we get tired of praising Him. It looks like He's always going, I got to tell this and I got to close. But you know, one of my beliefs, we've been in that church in Waterloo for 37 years, and over the years I learned, I don't never take up money to pay a light bill. And they had need for a roof. You know, a roof wasn't leaking. They put on bad shingles and they messed up because of the oil crisis several years ago. And I asked the Lord, I wanted to take up an offering. I said, Lord, you know we need a roof. I hear those songs. Everybody around was saying, oh, insurance? You know, bought us a roof. I said, I don't think I'm going to try it. I'm going to call him. Called the man, he came out. We talked and talked and talked. And I know the man fell in love with me. So the man who evaluated the roof, he wanted the job. He said, Reverend, I'm going to tell you. He said, I don't think it was much hail damage up there. He said, that man just liked you. He said, they called and said, they're going to buy you a roof. And now we have $38,000 sitting up in the bank waiting on the roof to be put on. And as soon as they get put on, they're going to send me another $7,500. So, you know, I purposed in my heart. I said, Lord, you know, this is my principle. I just believe that something like that, I don't want to burden these saints with that roof. I know, you know, how to take care. I didn't know how it was going to happen. That's how the Lord made it happen. And I'm telling you, the Lord is able to do exceedingly and abundantly more than you can ask and think. The scriptures that eyes have not seen and ears have not heard. He hasn't even entered into your imagination. The things that God hath in store. What's happened to your imagination? The scripture said that we would open up the
That's what you call time.
He said he would open up the window of heaven and pour you out a blessing.
And if you know what you can handle, I guess somebody else would have to handle whatever you left on. Amen. So as I come to a close, imagine this. Imagine this. Next council, how many? 1,000 got baptized in the greater Tri-State.
Just imagine. You can imagine the next council. Amen. So much money came in. Amen. That we had to start appropriating things for possibilities and the different things that we thought would be good to do.
Imagine this.
We don't even have to set up a full-time staff on the premises.
Come on, let's imagine this.
You need to be here every day at a council. What do you make on your day? Here's what you would make. Come on, be at the council.
That's just use imagination. Now, that's just a few points. Musicians, I'm sure you got some things you might want. Amen.
Are the pews comfortable? Maybe we need to.
What else can we think about? It's as easy as you using your God made you different from me. amen, so that you can come up with things in your area.
The power to become the sons of God. Use our imagination. Amen.